We are the paradoxical ape. Bipedal, naked, large-brained, long the master of fire, tools, and language, but still trying to understand ourselves. Aware that death is inevitable, yet filled with optimism. We grow up slowly. We hand down knowledge. We empathize and deceive. We shape the future from our shared understanding of the past. CARTA brings together experts from diverse disciplines to exchange insights on who we are and how we got here. An exploration made possible by the generosity of humans like you.
Summarizing today would be a task I'll leave for someone else, but I will make a few observations. Because, in fact, there is some commonality, I hope you're feeling a little bit of commonality here. And one of the questions that has been driving this field, the sort of cell and molecular field, but also convergently, human evolution in general, is this expansion of the brain. And quite remarkably, I think we are beginning to have models and an understanding of how that can happen. And this field that is emerging of cellular and molecular anthropology is going to be the driver that allows us to get the tools to do that. Now, there's a couple ways that we're learning that, you've heard. One is through sort of a very detailed cellular understanding. And, you know, while these two speakers, Wieland and Arnold, talked about it seemingly with different terminology, really very much the same story is emerging, that we have these apical or the inner stem cells and the outer stem cells. And it's really that outer population, it's the expanding population. This is a real discovery. This is a real understanding that allows us to really put some details to what's going on. Further, even within that population now, we know genes that are driving this proliferation and are remarkably involved. I think there's obviously much more to be learned, and Frank certainly, you know, in this whole field of brain evolution, people wonder whether there is certain area of the brain expands because it's needed and you get more complexity, or does the whole brain expand and then different areas get connected and show the specificity once the expansion has occurred? I don't think we really know the answer to that, but certainly Frank showed us how, in addition to the features of expanded brain, the connectivity is really a feature, and the identification of molecules that are important, or genes that are important for that, and the nature of that change is crucial. And you know, with this idea of how does this happen, what is it? What are the drivers that are making this happen? I think again, an amazing communality here, thinking about duplication and the genes that are associated with that duplication as at least being part of the story with regards to what is responsible for this happening. And even the timing of this is, I think, is quite remarkable. I think the final link in this for me is, you know, the actual phenotype. How are these morphological features relating to the identity of the unique features of what it means to be a human? And you know, this is where probably what we've learned today, at least, and we're learning a lot more, is the risks that we face at expansion of the brain and becoming human is not just the wonderful aspects of our ability to do things that other species can't, but also the dangers. And so this, we hear glioblastomas, we hear about autism, we hear the other risks of expanded brain, but also the other side of this story, and we've heard about this in our meetings before, are, you know, synesthesia and other features that are unique to human that are out there that are also a consequence of the expanded genome. So while we have, I am missing obviously a lot of the key features of what's going on. One thing I will end with is we've talked about this right now, are looking at the common features that are driving who we are, or human evolution, and a feature that we have to sort of consider is the and we heard it from Joanna and also from Evan, is the diversity, is this diversity that's a key feature. And I think that's going to be sort of a common theme as we get larger samples, we get larger model systems, will play into that and try to understand the importance of diversity, which we haven't had a chance to really talk about, why we need diversity in the population for the sustaining evolution, but also sustaining the population. So that's my attempt at providing for you a little bit of a structure to what we've obtained, and I admit to it being underestimated. Now, we do have some questions, and I'd like to end the talk picking out just a few things that allow the speakers to elaborate on a few points, and some of it, hopefully they'll... I'll start with this one nice statement from one of the audience saying, "All of you have created fabulous modern art, certainly on par with Frank Stella. When and where is your first art exhibition going to be?" There are actually some texts out there, but I think an art exhibit would be, of scientific art, would be a fun thing, and maybe we should think about doing that here in San Diego, collecting art and having an installation of some sort about science. I'll leave that to this. You've been thinking about that already? Okay, good. A couple questions. One I'll take because it two people. It's a reasonably sharp one. When ORGs and BRG clones become neurons, and this is actually for Wieland and for Arnold, do we know how they decide which layer to go to or how they get there, since they can't necessarily follow the glial precursors or the glial patterns? If not, is there any other way or working hypothesis how that happens? So you want to come up, Wieland and Arnold, and or Arnold? Let's see how similar their responses are. You can rephrase it any way you want.
Sure. Just to clarify a little bit, the neurons do indeed migrate along a glial scaffold. The deeper cortical layers appear in humans and probably other primates to migrate along those ventricular radial glia, very much like Pashko's model from 30 years ago, or, for example, how it happens in the mouse. Those neurons that are born in the second half, which are the upper cortical layer neurons, they actually generally hop from one fiber to another. This is actually something that Pashko reported in EM images, electron microscopic images that he made about 30 years ago, where he showed the leading fiber of a neuron actually moving over to another fiber a little distance away, while the trailing process remained on the original fiber. So the notion that neurons can actually hop from fiber to fiber is something that Pashko was aware of. And we think that has to happen at the later stages more than the early stages, which has a few predictions. One of them is that there may be more dispersion among clonally related cells in the upper cortical layers and the deeper cortical layers. And the other feature I didn't emphasize is that it's been known by work from Henry Kennedy and Coletta Hay that the upper cortical layers of primates have a higher density of pyramidal neurons than in other species. And that's thought to be a supergranular feature that's primate specific. And that discontinuous glial scaffold I showed you, I think, leads into or may be an explanation for how that happened. So I think that is a difference between primates, at least, and other species, having to do with the way the neurons get to their final targets.
Yeah, I can only 100% agree with what Arnold said, and maybe one small addition, which is that unpublished work suggests that the extracellular matrix makes fibrils, in particular in the cortical plate, and that may also contribute to this hopping that Arnold was referring to.
Great.
Great. Thank you, guys. Marcel, you want to take a couple of these?
Sure. Is that a question for Dr. Livesey? On is there significant human variation in the total number of neurons between individuals?
There's a famous comedy television show in the UK which has comedians running up to the microphone in response to quick questions. This feels a bit like that. Anyway, the short answer is no. But this is true of you. I mean, if you look across any species, you know, humans, although we go on and on about difference, we're all actually very similar, the same way that most mice, you know, we fall within a range. It's when you drop outside that range, that's when you get into pathology, like things like microcephaly.
About, could Zika virus be used to treat glioblastoma?
The short answer is yes. There are two recent papers that actually make that point, one from a group in the UK, another from the US, showing that Zika virus actually does infect progenitor cells or tumor-initiating cells in glioblastoma and can destroy them similar to the way it destroys progenitor cells in the developing human cortex. There are several problems with that or complications. One of them is that our work and others seems to suggest that the astrocytes in adult brain are extremely susceptible to viral infection with the Zika virus. And so although you deliver the virus directly to the tumor, you might be able to get rid of preponderance of some of the tumor cells. The risk would be that you'd also be able to get rid of quite a number of your normal astrocytes. So I'm not sure that's going to be a therapeutic approach, but indeed, you know, the virus, it has a tropism for those cancer-initiating cells, just like it does to the fetally derived progenitor cells as well.
Great. So, Joanna, can genetic analysis predict how much of the Neanderthal genome each one of us is carrying? Or how would you do that?
So, from genetic analysis, clearly, you know, we can look at and predict how much of Neanderthal genome is in each of our genomes. But the question is, I think, also interesting: can we predict how much of our looks are due to that interbreeding? So, I think we are getting interested in that question, since we're all walking around with Neanderthal introgressions, and could we look at the impact of those introgression on facial morphology, for example, and try to essentially make the connection again between the genome and the phenotype. So we are interested in that question very much.
Thanks. I'll end on this one for Evan. Are the syndromic conditions you've mentioned dependent or independent on consanguineous marriages? You can take that any direction you want to go with, but it.
So the answer is no. So consanguineous marriages are ones where you require inbreeding to essentially result in a genetic disease. And because these mutations are happening as you guys are sitting here making sperm and egg, well, some of you are making sperm and egg, they're happening all the time as is simply a consequence of our architecture. So all those kids that I showed, they effectively have one normal copy and one deleted copy. And in most cases, they're not inheriting them. They're just spontaneous big mutations that are happening in very hot regions of our genome because of the duplication architecture.
So that brings us to the conclusion of this symposium. I'd like to thank all the speakers for an incredible journey into the complex world of the genetic architecture and cellular events that lead to these things between our ears that allow us to try to understand what's happening. I thank you all for the questions and for still being with us here, and I hope everybody online who followed the symposium also enjoyed it. Remember, you can catch these symposia. In about 2 months, they will be edited and available to be viewed and shared with people you think might be interested in them. Thank you very much. Thank all the speakers and the audience.